Today I'm building a complete 10-inch home lab using only components bought from AliExpress. No name brands, no local retailers, no trusted vendors, just the cheapest parts I could find that technically meet my requirements. So for this video, I wanted to find out, can you actually build a functional home lab using only components sourced from AliExpress? Does it perform well enough to be usable and practical? And most importantly, is it actually any cheaper than buying entry-level name brand gear locally? To set a goal for the build, I defined a basic home lab as something that could realistically live in a home or small office and actually be useful. For me, that meant a 5-6U 10-inch rack, a router for internet access, a mini PC to run services, a gigabit switch to connect the home lab devices and others on my home network, a patch panel for clear I/O access, and some form of shared storage acting as a NAS. So every one of these components had to come from AliExpress, and for each category, I deliberately chose the cheapest option that met my minimum specs, and obviously didn't look like a total scam. All the pricing I talk about is in US dollars and includes delivery to my address. After around 2 weeks of waiting, this is what turned up. Let's start with the router. For this, my requirements were simple. Have Wi-Fi, preferably Wi-Fi 6, and gigabit Ethernet. I found this Fenvi AX3000 router, which claims Wi-Fi 6 on both 2.4 and 5 GHz. It's also got gigabit networking and even has a disclaimer about Australia's 3G shutdown, which is interesting given it doesn't appear to have 3G at all. This cost me just $28.70. If this actually works as advertised, then it's quite a lot cheaper than an entry-level name brand AX3000 router locally, which would usually be closer to $80. Next up is the network switch. This one was more difficult to find than expected. Mostly because AliExpress is absolutely flooded with 10-100 switches that are still being sold for budget CCTV systems. After some careful filtering, I found this Ling Power 8-port gigabit switch. There's not much to say here. If it switches packets at gigabit speed without dropping out, then it's technically done its job. This cost me just $9.73. Again, this is quite good, as something similar locally would cost around $20. Next up is the mini PC. And honestly, this was a hard purchase, as I wanted to buy something that could actually run an OS from this decade, but I also didn't want to spend a fortune on a component that's likely going to land up being e-waste. I settled for this brandless, industrial, fanless mini PC with an i3-4005U CPU. It's also got 8GB of RAM and 128GB of SSD storage. It's got pretty basic I/O, including a now archaic VGA port and zero USB-C ports. But at least it does have HDMI, gigabit Ethernet, and it's got some USB 3 ports. Finding a half-decent mini PC for a reasonable price is also made difficult because they often sell mini PCs on AliExpress without RAM or storage. Or they have product listings that advertise as being an i7 for a cheap price, but when you click on them, the i7 is actually a way more expensive model and the advertised price is for an i3 colored PC. For this mini PC, I paid $104.26. which I feel a bit ripped off about. We'll see how it performs, but this is essentially a 12-year-old piece of hardware, and you'd be able to buy a much better second-hand brand-name old workstation PC locally for a similar price. The only things going for it is that it's probably a new hardware, and it's likely low power draw since it's fanless. Next up is storage, and I know buying storage on AliExpress is pretty high up on the list of things never to do. To try and minimize the chance of being scammed, if that's even possible, I decided to try and buy two 1TB drives. 1TB SSDs have been around for a while and aren't high capacity or pushing any limits of what's technically available or achievable. So in my mind, these are the least likely to be misrepresented or scammy. So I set out looking for two 1TB SATA SSDs. I found these 100% original drives that look like they're trying to knock off Western Digital's coloring, although pricing between the colors doesn't change. They also have 80 reviews, with a lot of them being positive. These drives cost me $20.36 each, which is about a fifth of the price that they should have been locally. They should be closer to $100. To plug those into the mini PC, I've got these SATA to USB cables, which were $2.14 each. I then have a few other components to finish off the home lab, like keystone jacks, patch leads, a cool power switch, and a 120mm fan. We'll take a look at the total cost of all of the components and how that compares to a name brand system once it's all assembled. Next comes the Homelab rack, and for that I was limited to two options. Being a 10-inch rack, there aren't too many pre-builds available. I could buy a DeskPi Rackmate for around $80 to $120 plus shipping, depending on the size and accessories, Or the option that I eventually went with was to 3D print my own 5U Labrax Homelab using material sourced from AliExpress. So I bought two rolls of PETG, some M6 brass inserts, M6 screws, and some colored M6 screws for the front. These came to a total of $34, and I'd have enough filament to 3D print some shelves to hold all of the components, so I could finish it off without buying more flags or shelving hardware. So next let's get the Homelab and shelves printed out, and honestly this went quite well. I dried the filament for 8 hours each before printing, and all of the parts came out looking good. As with my other builds, this version of the Labrax system goes together with some brass inserts melted into the parts with a soldering iron. And then some M6 screws to hold them together. I've also installed the 120mm fan on the top panel with some M3 screws. Next we can start populating the shelves. I'm going top down from smallest to largest, so that the fan at the top is most effective in cooling the lower components. So at the top we've got the switch, then the mini PC. I've then put the drives in my NAS tray set up below that. Then a half-U patch panel and a half-U vent panel below that. And then the router on the bottom. I then tried to plug in the patch leads and other cables, and I had to rearrange the shelves to get everything to fit in. So that's effectively the AliExpress Homelab complete. Totaling it all up, this Homelab cost me $216.05, which in itself actually seems like a fairly good deal, if all of the components do what they say they will, and hopefully for longer than a couple of hours. I tried to do a rough estimate of what this would cost if I used locally available name brand components that were still relatively budget friendly, and I came out at $490. So this is less than half the price. So let's move on to doing some testing on it and see how the components perform or whether they work at all. I'm not actually going to hook this Homelab up to my home network. I have no idea what spyware or nefarious software has been installed on it, so I'm running this on an isolated guest network that only has internet access. The mini PC had Windows 10 on it, but I wasn't sure what else was installed on it, so I wiped the OS drive and installed Ubuntu, which is more appropriate for my Homelab in any case. Since we're on the PC, let's start with a CPU stress test. It's passively cooled, but it does have the 120mm fan above it. The PC did pretty well in that test. Temperature started out at 35 degrees, and it stabilized at around 45 degrees after 10 minutes. Running a Sysbench CPU benchmark, we get an average score of 6,148 over 3 tests. This is not a great result. It's about on par with a Raspberry Pi 4, which is a bit disappointing even though I wasn't expecting much from a 12-year-old CPU. Testing the OS drive speed, we get buffered reads of around 537 MB per second, which is quite good for a SATA drive. In terms of power consumption, the mini PC uses 6 watts at idle and 14 watts under full load, which is a bit higher than most modern computers running something like an N100 or N150 CPU. But it's not too bad for a simple Homelab PC. All up, I can't really fault the PC. The CPU is quite old, but I knew that when I bought it, and it seems to perform as expected in all tests. To me, being passively cooled is also a plus, as it produces no noise. Next, let's test the router. The web interface seems okay, it's all in English and has all of the basic features you'd expect from it. It's even got some parental controls and some block list features. I tested the internet speed both through a wired and a wireless connection. Wired, I got speeds between 850 and 900 megabits per second download and around 95 megabits per second upload, along with a ping of 5 to 7 milliseconds. Wireless, I got speeds of between 60 and 110 megabits per second download and a little over 80 megabits per second upload, with a ping around the same as the wired connection. The wired results were reasonably close to what I get off my main router. The ping is a bit slower, but this router's on an isolated guest network, so it's got the overhead of another router and a switch to work through, so the result's not all that bad. Wireless results were pretty bad, but looking at the adapter on the mini PC, it's a Wi-Fi 4 adapter from around 2012, so that's likely what's holding speeds back. Now let's test the switch. Running IPERF 3, we get transfer speeds of around 940 megabits per second, which is pretty good. I didn't want to connect more of my day-to-day computers to this network, but having a bit of traffic on the network would have made the test a bit more strenuous. Now let's move on to the storage drives, where I don't have high hopes that I've avoided being scammed. I started off formatting the drives on a burner PC, in case they had anything on them to start. After that, the drive was readable on my PC and showed up as having it stated 1TB capacity, or very close to it at 953GB. But what often happens with these drives is that they actually only have like 32 or 64 gigs of capacity, and either won't allow you to write more data than this to the drive, or the controller just keeps writing over the old data. So when you try access your files, only the most recent ones will actually work, and the older ones will be lost. To test this, I used H2TestW, which basically writes the drive full and then checks the information written to see if there's any errors on it. The test initially said that it would take just over an hour to complete. Although the write speed started off at over 250 megabytes per second, this dropped to under 80 after 10 minutes, and then down to under 30 for the remainder of the test. There are quite a few reasons that play into the drop, but it does show that the drive really is using budget tier hardware. After 2.5 hours, the real issue popped up. The test stopped being able to write at 122 gigabytes. I was able to verify the contents written to that point successfully, but the drive wouldn't allow anything else to be written to it. I ran the test a second time on that drive, and once more on the other drive, and each time I got similar results. Sometimes the test ran a bit faster, but it always stopped around 122 gigabytes. So it looks like these are actually only 128 gig drives, which aligns a lot more with the price that I paid for them. Running a transfer speed test on them from the mini PC, buffered reads are pretty bad at 23 megabytes per second. The drives also don't show up any useful manufacturer or model name. I opened one of the drives up to see what's inside of it, and I found a reasonably normal looking PCB. Interestingly though, searching for the chip's part number brings up no technical results, only other people who are also complaining about being scammed with drives that they've also bought from unreliable sources. So I guess this test aligned with my expectations. I thought it was quite likely that I'd be scammed, and although I tried to do a few things to avoid it, I wasn't successful. So that leaves me with the question, is it worth it to build a Homelab off AliExpress, or should you rather buy name brand hardware? From a pure does it function perspective, this Homelab does actually work, but honestly, I think you'd be far better off spending a similar amount of money on some better quality used hardware. The actual Homelab frame, made from AliExpress filament, brass inserts, screws, and even the fan, I can't really fault. There were no issues with the screws or fitting the parts together, and if you're prepared to wait, then you can save a bit of money by buying these items off AliExpress. The mini PC is usable, but it's already a decade out of date, and I think you could get a better deal on a secondhand workstation like a Lenovo ThinkStation or Dell Precision T-Series. The router's much the same. It works, but you could probably find an old Netgear Nighthawk or TP-Link Archer for a similar price on Marketplace. The switch is good value for an 8-port, but I doubt it's going to last very long, so for an extra 15 bucks, rather get a name brand one. The drives are a straight up scam, and confirm you should never buy storage off AliExpress. At their 128GB capacity, they're actually more expensive than equivalent name brand drives. So my takeaway is this. AliExpress can make sense for passive components like mechanical parts, cabling, hardware accessories, or even things like racks and enclosures if you're willing to wait. But for the core infrastructure, you're almost always better spending similar money on some used name brand hardware that was designed to last. Let me know what you think of the build in the comment section below, and what you think I should do with this Homelab next. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.